Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Castle War by John DeChancie, narrated by Kyle Burrow. Fate sits on these dark battlements and frowns, and as the portal opens to receive me, a voice in hollow murmurs through the courts, tells of a nameless deed. Anne Radcliffe, 1764 to 1823, The Mysteries of Udolpho. Throne Room. Incarnadine, Lord of the Western Pale, sat in state on the Siege Perilous. Bring in the prisoner! High in the cavernous chamber, a bat screeched. Something small and furry skittered across the floor and vanished into a shadowy corner. Wrists manacled, the prisoner shuffled in, dragged by two guardsmen. He was pushed to the floor in front of the throne. Rise. Chuckling, the prisoner got up slowly. His frayed gray tunic was filthy, his black tights torn and ripped. Your Majesty, how kind of you to grant me audience. We welcome our faithful vassal, Sir Jean Ferraro. The irony fairly dripped. How does His Majesty fare? It goes well with us. His serene and transcendent Majesty smiled crookedly. You, on the other hand, look rather pale and haggard. Aren't my jailers treating you properly? Not a day goes by when I am not the beneficiary of their kind attentions. I am glad. Getting enough to eat? Unfortunately, sire, there is only so much rubbish one can consume at a sitting. So much slop. So much swill. The king looked saddened. No appetite. I will have your rations reduced so that this no longer presents a problem. His Majesty is too gracious a host. No amenity must be spared for a true and faithful servant. I fear I am not quite that, sire. No, perhaps not. Perhaps servant is not the proper designation. Can you think of one more apt? Sir Jean smiled thinly. I am sure His Majesty can supply any number more apt. Traitor, perhaps. Regicide. Failed regicide, the prisoner corrected. Murderous villain? The king's voice boomed inside the dark chamber. Foul usurper? Sir Jean shrugged. Again, unsuccessful. Regarding murder, may I remind His Majesty that I learned the art at the knees of a true master. You, the guardsman to the right, drove a mailed fist into the prisoner's side just under the ribcage. The prisoner doubled up and sank to his knees. He was some time in getting up again. A silent, fluttering movement in the darkness above. Another bat. The king settled back in his throne. You learned not well enough. Sir Jean drew a painful breath before answering. How well I know. We have more lessons to teach. There is the discipline of the wheel, for instance, and the brand, and the boot. Ah, you hide your fear well, but you will scream as loudly as the others. I trust it will amuse His Majesty to contemplate that this time the victim will not be entirely innocent. A royal scowl spoils the fun, really. True, true. But we'll do our best to enjoy the proceedings. The king sighed. There is not much else to say, but I suppose protocol demands that I pronounce sentence. He raised his right hand, took a long breath, then said hurriedly, By the right and power vested in me, I hereby condemn you to a deliciously prolonged death with all the trimmings. He grinned. The prisoner bowed. Take him away. The prisoner was led out of the throne room. In the corridor outside, the guardsmen steered their charge to the left. At the next intersecting hallway, they turned right, went down a stairwell, and turned left at the landing. The three were walking along when suddenly the prisoner stopped and doubled over, groaning. The guardsman on the left said,
"What's with you then?"
"My side, it's on fire."
The other one snickered.
"Only a taste of what's to come."
"Please, you must."
"No malingering now."
"I can't walk."
"You landed him a good one, you did,"
the one on the left said.
"It likely burst something."
"It was just a tap."
"Let's be on our way back to the cell. You can lie down there."
"I want the court physician."
"Can't oblige, good sir knight."
"If I die prematurely, Incarnadine will have your heads."
The one on the right looked worried.
"He's right, you know."
"I suppose he is.
Come along, we'll take you to the Sawbones straight away."
"I tell you, I can't walk."
"Pick up his feet."
"You pick up his feet. I've got the rest of him."
"Just our luck if he dies. I've got a good mind to..."
The prisoner kicked out and connected with a solar plexus. One guardsman doubled over. Then, pivoting quickly, he swung his manacled fists around and clouted the other alongside the head. Both men went down, and he ran. He dashed left at the next intersection, having a certain destination in mind. It was one of the castle's lesser-known aspects, and if he could get through it, he could lose himself in a dense forest. He knew a cave not far away where he could hide. Shouts echoing behind him, he willed what was left of his strength into his legs. He lurched left at the next crossing passageway, ran, turned right, ran, then bore right again. He burst into a spacious room. In the darkness to the rear lay the arched entrance to a small adjoining chamber, which he made for directly. Once through the archway, he halted and gasped in dismay. There was supposed to be an aspect here, a magical doorway to another world. Instead, there lay before him another long, nondescript corridor, of which there were countless thousands in the castle. He desperately glanced around. This was the right chamber. He knew it well. A veteran guest in Castle Perilous, he had a keen sense of direction and layout. One needed such talents in the vast labyrinth of the castle. The magic doorway was clearly gone. Aspects were known to disappear on occasion, but this particular one was extraordinarily stable, or had been since he had taken up residence in the castle. Rotten luck to have it vanish when he needed it most. Double bad luck to have picked this one when there were two or three others close by that would have served in a pinch. But this world had offered a forest to hide in. The others provided less ideal cover. Footsteps closed outside. Too late to make a dash for the alternate escape routes. He was cut off. He bolted forward. The only choice was to keep running. But he knew it was only a matter of time before he was chased down. The alert would go out. His one chance was to make it to one of the unstable areas of the castle, where wild aspects flickered in and out of existence, where doors opened up to anywhere, sometimes to oblivion. But even oblivion was preferable to the refined diversions that Incarnadine's torturers had in store for him. He raced on into a gloom relieved only by a few strange lighting fixtures in the shape of faceted jewels that glowed faintly blue. He ran by an occasional blind alcove, no aspects in them. He passed two stairwells, then came to a third. He entered and went down two floors, stopping at the landing to check the adjoining corridor. No one. He sprinted to the left, then made a series of turns, running blindly now, unaware of exactly where he was heading. He ran until his diminished stamina gave out. He jogged along, then loped. He stopped to get a second wind and jogged some more. His pace gradually petered out to a walk. Breathing hard, he stopped, leaned against the dark stone wall. He slowed his breath and listened. Nothing. No footsteps, no voices. Could it be? Had he truly lost his pursuit? The quiet closed in around him. Miracle of miracles. Now he would have a chance to find an amenable aspect. He knew of several where he could hide out a while. He knew of others into which he could disappear for a very long time indeed, and that is what he desired. The castle was no longer safe. He had tried to take it, make it his, but had failed miserably. No matter, Incarnadine would never find him. He would hide, biding his time. It would take years, perhaps, but somehow he would raise an army and return. He would invade Castle Perilous, depose Incarnadine, and take the throne. Good, he thought. It was essential to have a plan, to keep ambitions alive. He began walking again. Suddenly, he stopped, looked about. Something was strange. His castle sense was giving him mixed signals. The surroundings were familiar, but there was something odd. He could not grasp quite what. He shrugged it off and continued. He wandered for what seemed like hours. No one was about. The sense that something was amiss did not leave him. He could not shake the feeling that somehow, in some inexplicable way, he had left the castle. But that was impossible, for clearly he was still inside it. He had not crossed an aspect. Or had he? There lingered an inescapable feeling that he had. There was a sixth sense about it as well. He knew when the castle gave way to one of its contingent worlds. There was always a sense of going out, of leaving, as now. But what had he entered? What sort of world was like the castle itself? He turned a corner and collided with a guardsman.
Jean!
Stunned, he regarded the man, whom he recognized and knew well. It was no less than Tyrene, captain of the guard. What he could not fathom was why Tyrene was giving him the friendliest of smiles. Tyrene's gaze lowered to Jean's hand, and his expression turned quizzical.
What's this? Lady Linda playing some sort of prank?
Sir Jean looked at the manacles, then at Tyrene. He had no answer, nor did he have an explanation for why Tyrene looked different until he realized that the ugly, cancerous mole on the man's right cheek was gone. Tyrene laughed.
Too embarrassed to say? Here.
He reached into a pocket and pulled out a ring of keys.
I should have a master here somewhere.
Sir Jean remained silent as Tyrene searched for the key, found it, and released him.
Thank you, Sir Jean said, rubbing his wrists.
Tyrene examined the manacles.
Did Linda conjure these, or do they come from the dungeon?
I'm afraid I don't know.
It's all right. It's a rare prisoner we have these days. I'll see that they get stored away properly.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, must be going. Duty, you know. With Lord Incarnadine away, things tend to get a mite frantic.
Tyrene walked off, whistling off-key. Sir Jean stared after him, amazed beyond words. When the silence returned, he fell into contemplation. At length, he reached a conclusion. He did not understand why or how, but it was clear that he had been presented with a golden opportunity. Sir Jean Ferraro was not a man to let such pass by. Queen's Dining Hall. It was breakfast and everyone was up early. The long dining table was heavy with food in every variety imaginable. The coffee flowed, and so did the conversation. Linda Barclay turned to one of the servants.
Orin, did you wake Jean already?
I did, m'lady.
He's hard to get up sometimes. Do you know when his plane leaves?
Your pardon, m'lady, I do not.
Linda sipped her coffee. She looked up at Orin again. Do you know what an airplane is?
Orin wasn't sure.
A flying machine?
Right. I'm never sure how much you born castle people know about our world.
Oh, we know a bit, m'lady. I've never seen a flying machine, but I'm very sure I wouldn't fancy taking a ride in one.
I've always been afraid to fly, too. The man whom everyone called Monsieur DeChancie was sitting across the table.
"I've never flown in my life," he said.
Cleve Dalton, thin and middle-aged, was seated next to him.
"I always liked flying. Always meant to get a private license. Took lessons, even soloed, but never took the written test."
He lifted his coffee cup. "By the way, what's Jean going back to school for?" Dina Williams answered.
"You mean, why is he going back, or what's he gonna study?"
"I guess I mean both. Sorry, I'm always out on the golf course, so I don't know what's going on half the time."
Thaxton, a dapper man in his late 30s, said,
"You don't know what's going on half the time on the course, Dalton, old boy."
"I know enough to beat you more than half the time."
"Golf's not my game. You know that."
"Yes, of course. It's tennis, which I hate."
"Jean's going to study computer science," Linda said. "Grad school at Caltech."
"Very good school," Dalton said, impressed. "Why computers?"
"Well, Jean has always had this inferiority thing about his not being very good in magic. He needs to compensate. Computers he thinks he can handle." Jeremy Hawksdaughter came in yawning. He looked in his teens, but was a bit older.
"Speaking of computers," Dina said, "here comes the whiz kid now."
"Morning, everybody," Jeremy said between yawns. "Sorry, up all night with the castle mainframe again."
"How's the rebuilding going?" Dalton asked.
"Oh, so-so. The CPU is working, but the operating system is still full of bugs."
Jeremy helped himself to eggs and bacon. Linda said, "Jean also thinks he can help with the magic if he learns computers."
"Magic and computers," Dina said with a shake of her head. "Crazy. Incantations, pentacles, all that stuff is old-fashioned," Jeremy said.
"Why can't you run a spell through a computer?"
"Why not?"
Dina said with a shrug.
"Can't stop progress," Jeremy said.
"I also think that Jean needs to get back to reality," Linda said. "I think maybe all of us need to get back sometimes."
"Not me," Dalton said. "I'll take the castle over reality any day."
Thaxton buttered some toast while commenting,
"According to our host, the castle is reality. Everything else is just an adjunct."
"What's an adjunct?" Dina asked.
"Something that's secondary. The castle creates all the worlds it provides access to."
Linda said, "Well, that's not entirely true. The way I understand it, I mean, the way Lord Incarnadine explained it to me, is that there are an infinite number of possible universes, but they don't really exist in the normal sense. They just sort of hang out there until the castle makes them real, I guess."
"That's more or less it," Thaxton said.
"And the castle chooses 144,000 of these universes and creates access doors that we all go traipsing through."
"You've hit it on the head."
"But I really don't emotionally accept it," Linda went on. "I still can't accept the castle as anything but a long-lived fantasy. I think Jean has trouble with it, too. That's why he feels he has to get back once in a while. Back to the gritty, real world we came from."
"All good luck to Jean," Dalton said. "But I'm staying right here."
"I ain't going nowhere either," Dina said. "I didn't have it so great back in Bed-Stuy."
Dalton said,
"I think all of us are here because of problems in the so-called real world. That's what opens a door into this place, a willingness to chuck it all and leave."
"You really think so?" Linda asked.
"Of course. Haven't you ever wondered why only certain types show up here?"
"Now that you mention it, I have."
"Sure. And haven't you ever wondered why whole worlds don't come pouring through? It's because only a few people, beings, can get through those magical doorways. To everyone else, they are shut tight."
We have had a few invasions, Linda said.
Well, I was speaking generally, of course. The hosts of Hell were certainly an exception.
And so were the Blue Meanies a little while back, Dina said. I hated those dudes. I wonder how they got in then, Linda said.
Perhaps a whole world full of beings can hate their own world, Thaxton said.
I doubt it, Dalton said. It just goes to show that there are no hard and fast rules to Castle Perilous. You have to be on your toes all the time.
Good morning.
All heads turned to Jean Ferrero as he came striding in, lugging two huge suitcases. Unlike most of his fellow guests, who were in vaguely medieval garb, Jean was dressed in sweatpants, running shoes, t-shirt, and windbreaker. He also wore a big grin.
You're finally up, Linda said.
All ready for my first day of kindergarten, and you won't even have to walk me to the school bus. He dropped the luggage and sat down. Hope I have time for breakfast. He started heaping flapjacks onto a plate.
What time is your plane? Linda asked.
11:10. Hope they're ready at halfway to take me to the airport. It's a long drive into Pittsburgh.
Orin said, I'm to tell you, sir, that Hulbert is standing by with the motor car.
Fine. Bert's the best driver of the lot.
Dalton said, Before you arrived, Jean, we were all speculating as to why you were going back to school. Why don't we get it from the horse's mouth?
Maybe it's not the mouth my reasons come from, Jean said, but never mind. All I can say is, the prospect of hanging around a castle for the rest of my life, polishing my sword, has its attractions. But I have to prove something to myself.
What's that, Jean?
That I don't have to be here. Don't get me wrong, I want to be here, but I don't want it to be the only place I can exist. So, I'm going back to school to study something worthwhile and do something with it.
Like what?
Like get a job. I'll work for as long as it takes to pay my parents back for putting me through college. My dad took a bath when the stock market crashed a little while back. He's looking at retirement with a skimpy portfolio and not a lot of savings. They have equity in the house, but you gotta have a roof over your head. So, I'm going back to the real world for a while to help him out.
Linda smiled at Dalton. I told you.
Well, I think that's very commendable, Jean, Dalton said.
Thank you.
Linda asked, Is Sheila coming to see you off?
No. I saw her and Trent last night. Said our goodbyes. I really wanted Lord Incarnadine to be here, though.
Thaxton looked around. Does anyone know where our host is and what he's doing?
As usual, Dalton said. He's on one of his secret missions. Most likely diplomatic doings in an aspect where he has some political interest.
Is there an aspect where he doesn't have political interest? Linda asked.
Oh, a few, I imagine, Thaxton said. One man can't look after 144,000 worlds.
I wouldn't put anything past Lord Incarnadine, Linda said.
Sure, I know that a lot of aspects are unstable and nobody goes there, but I bet Incarnadine looks after political stuff in several hundred at least.
You may be right, Dalton said. Then drained his coffee cup. Well, I'm off. I mean to get in 9 holes before lunch. Are you with me, Thaxton?
Thaxton pulled his golf bag out from under the table.
Let's have a go.
Jean, Dalton said, holding out a hand. I wish you the best of luck.
Jean shook. Thanks. Dalton and Thaxton left. Linda asked, Are you coming back for Thanksgiving?
It depends on what my folks have planned. I really don't know if I can make it back here. I'll try, though. Definitely be back for Christmas.
I planned on going back to California for Christmas, Linda said sadly.
Looks like we're not going to see each other till summer.
I'm going to miss you, swordsman.
Same here, sorceress.
They exchanged smiles for a second, then Jean resumed pouring maple syrup. So, Via is staying at Pitt?
Yeah, Jean said. For one more trimester, then she's transferring to UCLA. They've already accepted her for the winter term.
She's done wonderfully for someone who didn't even know English a year ago.
Osmeric really accomplished miracles with her. But I think Incarnadine worked some magic, too. No one can learn English that good that fast.
I don't know. Via's a remarkable woman.
You're telling me.
Got a scoop for us? Are you two going to get married?
Ask Via about that. According to her tribe's customs, we're already married. For life. Real serious stuff. Which is fine by me. Just dandy. We might make it Earth legal, though. The only trouble about living together will be the commute between West LA and Pasadena.
So, where are you going to live?
Don't know yet. I'll be in the dorm for this term. But when Via gets out there, we're going to have to search for an apartment. How the hell we're going to afford it, I'll never know. The rents out there are ridiculous. It might be all moot, though. I'll probably flunk out of Caltech.
Gene, don't put yourself down.
Well, I don't think I'm going to fit in with the techno-weenie set.
Hey, watch that, Jeremy said.
Present company accepted.
Just then, a 7-foot-tall creature with milk-white fur padded into the hall. It had yellow eyes and long, sharp teeth with long, bone-white claws. For all of that, it looked friendly.
Snowclaw!
Hi, guys, Snowclaw said.
You made it, Jean said.
I thought I wouldn't get to say goodbye to you. You disappeared.
I wanted to get in some hunting before the freeze hit. Well, the freeze came early, so I came back. Though I would have anyway, just to see you off.
Glad you did. Sit down and eat some napkins or something.
I'll just munch on these candles. I'm really not hungry.
That's news. So, are you going back to Hyperborea, or are you going to stay a while in the castle?
I can't pronounce that.
What's the name in your language?
Snowclaw growled and snapped. Jean said,
I can't even begin to get my tongue around that.
To answer your question, I'll probably go back. Gonna be kind of lonely here with you gone. Sure wish I could go with you.
You and me both. But you'd raise a few eyebrows in Pasadena. Maybe not in LA, but Pasadena, yes.
Yeah, Snowclaw said. The last time I went to Earth, I really got myself in trouble.
Everyone at the table laughed.
Jean said, those headlines were great. Abominable snowman stalks Western PA. And then there was the story in one of the tabloids. Saucerlands captures Bigfoot. Right up there with Elvis alive and living in Scarsdale.
If you hadn't come along in that contraption of yours, I'd still be there getting shot at by the locals. I'm still digging buckshot out of my rear end.
Well, it wasn't the first time I had to pull your chestnuts out of the fire.
And it might not be the last. Wait a minute. It seems to me that I have saved your hide once or twice.
Just kidding, big guy. We made a great team, you and me.
Yeah, and now you're off to get some book learning, and I'll probably never see you again.
Are you kidding? We'll get together again. There are 100,000 worlds in this castle I haven't explored yet, and I wouldn't want anyone at my back but you.
Nice of you to say, Jean, old buddy. Same here.
Snowclaw hung his head.
Hey, I'm getting misty-eyed.
Don't get maudlin on me.
I'll live.
Linda said, you guys make a great mutual admiration society. Jean shook his head.
It's embarrassing, isn't it?
I'm only kidding. Friendship is nice. Jean glanced up to the pendulum clock on the wall. The sign under it read, Eastern Daylight Time, Earth.
Holy smoke, I'm late.
Jean gulped coffee, wiped his mouth, and threw down his napkin.
Gotta go.
He stood. Snowclaw held out his paw,
which was more or less a short-fingered hand with claws.
See you around, Jean.
Jean shook paws. Take care of yourself. I'll be back. Remember.
Right.
Linda came up and hugged him. Do good in school. Will do. Don't take any wooden talismans. Dina took her turn hugging. Come back and visit, you hear?
Sure will. So long, Monsieur Duquesne.
Au revoir.
Bye, everyone.
Toting his luggage, Jean hurried out. Linda sat back down and began nibbling at a croissant. She looked thoughtful. She said, I wonder if he's making the right move. He needs adventure. Pasadena's not going to provide that.
There's always the Rose Bowl, Dina said.
Castle Keep, guest residence.
Are you coming?
Thaxton called irritably. Dalton had stopped to chat with a servant and another guest. He turned his head.
Hold your horses.
Haven't got all day.
Dalton said goodbye and hefted his clubs. He came down the corridor toward Thaxton.
Since when are you in a hurry to play golf?
Sorry, hate to stand about while somebody dawdles.
You are one irascible bloke.
I said I was sorry,
Thaxton said.
I have to wheedle and cajole to get you to play golf, and now you can't wait.
You said you wanted to do 9 holes before lunch, and I'm already hungry.
Why didn't you fill up at breakfast?
Can't eat a big breakfast usually. Stomach's upset when I get up. Incipient ulcer. Been meaning to... Hello? What's this?
Thaxton had stopped in front of the archway that led to the world of the golf course.
Now what the bloody hell is going on?
Dalton rubbed his chin.
Looks different, doesn't it?
Well, yes. There used to be trees. Then the clubhouse on the left, then the first tee.
What they saw was a tee and a long, beautiful fairway that dog-legged to the right. The surroundings were familiar enough. Dense forest.
They must have cleared some brush, Thaxton said.
Must have, Dalton said.
What hole is this?
Don't know.
Dalton crossed the boundary and continued walking.
Where are you going?
To play golf, Dalton said over his shoulder.
Why? What's wrong? I don't like the look of it.
It's a course, isn't it?
Now wait just a... Oh, bother!
Thaxton picked up his bag and followed. Dalton was already teeing up. He straightened, walked to the edge of the terrace, and surveyed the course. There was a steep drop off the tee, but most of the fairway was level.
Looks about a par 5, Dalton said. They must have done some landscaping.
When? There hasn't been time.
Magic, I guess.
Thaxton looked about. The portal was a standing oblong of grayness set against the greenery.
Shouldn't we check with the groundkeeper? I can't see the clubhouse anywhere.
Dalton addressed the ball.
Oh, it's around here somewhere.
I want a caddy.
The exercise won't do you harm.
See here, are you going to just go ahead and play?
Why not? It's a lovely course. Looks like they've trimmed the rough out a bit.
Thaxton scowled.
I don't know about this.
Dalton swung. The ball arched on a perfect trajectory and landed about 200 yards down the middle of the fairway.
Topping drive, Thaxton said.
Not so great on distance. One of these days, I'm going to get some power into my swing.
Dalton picked up the tee and pocketed it. Thaxton teed up.
I really wanted a caddy, or at least a cart.
Complaints, complaints. I wasn't kidding about needing exercise. My cardiologist used to insist on it, back when I needed a cardiologist.
I need a drink.
Before lunch, Dalton said archly.
Don't get on your bloody high horse. I've seen you swill enough at odd times of the day.
True, true,
but never directly after breakfast. It hampers the digestion.
You mean it hampers the alcohol from getting into your blood?
That too. Shoot. Thaxton made his shot. It was a horrible slice, and the ball landed perilously near the rough.
Damn it to hell! Bad lie, it looks like.
You're still on the fairway.
Rotten approach to the green.
Dalton sized it up. You could have picked a better angle.
Let's be off.
They walked out onto the fairway. The wet grass was clipped short. The sky was overcast, and a cool wind was up.
Not the best weather, Thaxton said.
Seems good enough.
Thaxton squinted at the sky. Looks like rain to me.
Won't rain if it keeps up.
What? Oh, spare me.
They separated about 50 yards out, Thaxton veering to the right. Dalton reached his ball and rooted for an iron. Thaxton had lost sight of his ball and searched for it, mumbling. At length, he chanced upon it and threw down his bag.
I can't even see the bloody green, he called.
Dalton pointed ahead, then addressed his ball. Thaxton's attention was drawn in the other direction toward the tee. A sound like a great rushing of wind came from the sky.
What the bleeding blazes!
The source hove into view. It swooped down from the sky, pinions flapping, green and golden scales shimmering. It landed on the fairway. The wings folded elaborately, the long barbed tail snaking to and fro. Its tapered head was many-toothed and golden-eyed, and pale blue flame fluttered from its mouth. A picket fence of triangular fins ran down the length of its back and tail. Thaxton watched it. The beast snuffled around in some bushes to the right of the tee until it found something suitable. The powerful jaws closed. It uprooted a plant and chewed contentedly. Thaxton cupped a hand to the side of his mouth.
I say, Dalton, old boy.
Huh?
Tell me, that's a flying dinosaur.
What? Oh. They both watched the thing forage. Dalton said, I think that's your garden variety dragon.
What the devil's it doing here?
Maybe it's the groundkeeper.
Looks like we can't go back that way, Thaxton said.
I'm playing through no matter what. Dalton determinedly took his stance. He swung. The ball described a lazy arc toward the green.
Right, Thaxton said. Carry on.
Bloody hell, he said to himself. Keep, Earth Aspect. Jean stood before the castle doorway that led to Earth and home.
What the hell?
What he should have been looking at was the interior of a spacious country manor. Located in Westmoreland County, Pennsylvania, Halfway House served as a station between the castle and Earth. But all that appeared beyond the outline of the portal was an expanse of empty meadow fringed by a line of trees. He looked up and down the hallway in the castle. No one was about. The guards would have been on either side of the portal, stationed in the house. Damn thing must have moved again. The portal did sometimes shift, and usually Sheila Jankowski or Incarnadine would have to be summoned to nudge it back again. Jean picked up his luggage and stepped through. He looked around. The terrain looked familiar. He guessed he was on the other side of the hill to the rear of the house. No problem. He'd just hike to the house and tell the guards where the portal had drifted to. One of them would have to step back into the castle and fetch Sheila, who would try to anchor the doorway back to the house again. It happened all the time. Very annoying. Stepping briskly over dewy grass, Jean made his way up the knoll. The sun was low and the air was cool, conveying a hint of autumn. Reaching the crest, he experienced a moment of disorientation until he realized the meadow was on the house side of the hill, but the house was gone. Moreover, the grove looked as though the house had never been there. This might be Earth, but it was one where Halfway House did not exist, had never existed. Everything else looked the same, but Jean knew he was not in the world where he belonged. He checked the portal, a barely visible rectangle, one-dimensional and anomalous, standing in the hayfield below. It seemed to shimmer a bit, but looked stable enough. There was nothing to do but go back to the castle. Something had happened to the Earth Perilous Link, and Jean would probably miss his plane. Rats! He couldn't muster much disappointment. This surprised him. He suddenly realized that he really wasn't as keen on going back to school as he thought. So why was he going? He sat down on one of the suitcases and thought about it. The reason might be a sense of obligation to his parents, or maybe a feeling of guilt for letting them down. After all, they had expected a lot from him. At first, things had gone pretty good. He took his BA, magna cum laude, and entered grad school, but he quit to try law school. He dropped out of that too, then drifted in and out of a series of odd jobs. Eventually, he wound up living at home, staring out windows. At that point, he stumbled into Castle Perilous, and his life of fantasy began. Sometimes, the thought that it all might be a hallucination nettled him. The hallucination hypothesis was still in the running. If true, the castle was the most convincing phantasm in medical history, having as it did tactile and olfactory dimensions, as well as visual and oral ones. It had more. It had downright spatial dimensions. It was the biggest delusion going. Put medical speculations aside, hallucination or not, the castle represented something in his psyche. What was it? The desire to escape? Now you're talking. Escape what? Life. Why? Because life, as he knew it and had lived it, was disappointing. It was drab. It was colorless. It was the proverbial idiot-spun tale, full of sound, but not a whole hell of a lot of fury unless you counted random violence, which it had in abundance, but which was simply stupid. To him, fury connoted something interesting, even significant. He craved a little significance. He wanted to accomplish something, to be involved in some activity that was not mundane, not quotidian. The castle had given him a taste of that. He had seen 1,000 new worlds and had had adventures in 6. He had met Vaya in one of those worlds. As much fun as sword and sorcery could be, though, it was not enough. He felt obligated to apply himself to some significant, there was that word again, some important task. He wanted to find a cause worthy of his dedication. It was as simple as that. The plan to help his parents was only the handiest one he could think of. As plans go, it wasn't bad at all, but it certainly was mundane. Yeah, it sure was. Caltech was a fine school. Computer programming? That sure as hell was not going to light his fire. Fiddling with computers was dandy, and he really did want to learn, but something was coming. There came a whine of turbines, the roar of jets. Trees swayed and birds flushed from cover. Before he could move, it was hovering directly above him at treetop level, angry with flashing red lights. It was some sort of VTOL craft, vertical takeoff and landing, pronounced VTOL, with stubby wings and a bubble cockpit. Cylindrical weapon pods bristled from its side and nose. The thing looked military and deadly. A loudspeaker burped, then blared.
You there! Identify yourself!
The noise of the engine was surprisingly subdued, more a deafening whisper than a roar. The voice was louder. It hurt his ears. Jean was suddenly irked.
Who wants to know?
After a pause, the male voice came back.
Don't move. If you move, you will be shot. Repeat, do not move.
Yeah, right.
The craft landed on the crest of the hill, the downward blast flattening unmown hay. The whine of the engine died, and the cockpit popped open. A helmeted man and woman climbed out wearing army fatigues and brandishing machine pistols. They approached. The man spoke.
What's your cognomen, citizen?
Cognomen? My name is Gene. What's yours?
We're recording. Recite your omnicode.
Say what?
Get up.
The man trained his gun on Gene. To the woman, he said,
pat him down.
Arms out, the woman barked. She was short, light-browed, and heavy. Gene spread his arms. The woman frisked him. He winced when she shoved her hand into his crotch. She came away with his wallet and airline ticket and handed them over to the man. She covered Gene while the man examined the articles.
What's this garbage? He said.
Gee, now that could just be my wallet full of traveler's checks and my goddamn airplane ticket for my goddamn flight, which I am now late for. They looked at each other. Maladapt? The woman ventured.
How do you explain these?
The woman peered at the wallet and ticket. She shrugged. Out person?
Maybe. He's not an out forces agent. He wouldn't be sitting here.
Funny clothes.
Yeah.
The man raised his gun.
You, come with us.
Prodded by gun barrels, Gene walked to the craft. He glanced in the direction of the portal but couldn't see it. He wondered if his captors would notice it and what their reaction would be if they did. There was a seat in a rear compartment that was separated from the cockpit proper by a metal gate, as in a squad car. They ushered Gene in and closed the rear hatch. The woman went back for the suitcases. These they had a hard time sorting in the cramped confines of the cockpit, but they managed. The woman was the pilot. She nicked switches and the engine revved up. The craft lifted straight up, rotated slowly to the right, then began moving forward. The craft gained altitude and speed. Gene could see through the grate and watched the countryside roll by. There were very few farmhouses. Most of the buildings were ugly concrete high-rises. He thought he could see masses of people out in the fields. Now in full forward flight, the craft leveled off and cruised. The speed was considerable. Fields and farms gradually gave way to the beginnings of a suburban sprawl. More loathsome high-rises, a river below. Gene wondered if it was the Monongahela or if the geography was totally different here. It was a short trip. Presently, taller buildings came into view. Stark steel towers arranged among squat pyramidal structures. Now he found out about the geography. Gene recognized the confluence of three rivers and knew that on this site, in another world, the city of Pittsburgh stood. What was laid out below was a different place altogether. The craft landed on the roof of a tall, wedge-shaped office building. At gunpoint, he was escorted out of the craft and into an elevator, which descended endlessly. When the doors opened, Gene guessed the floor was underground. He was told to go right, and he did, following a long, bright corridor that put him in mind of a hospital. Near the end of the corridor was a series of doors. He was told to stop in front of one of them. The man pressed a stud on the wall, and the door hissed open. He was motioned inside. He went in. The cubicle was small. Walls, ceilings, and floor were padded. There was nothing else in the room. The door slid shut, and he was alone. Cold, bright light came from a glowing panel recessed in the ceiling. There was lettering stenciled on the walls. Slogans. One wall read, "Freedom is responsibility." The opposite wall told him, "Peace is constant struggle."
The back wall stated, "Conscience is..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.